हैव अ ग्रेट डे स्टूडेंट्स. टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस प्रोसेस शेड्यूलिंग एंड डिफरेंट क्यूज. बट बिफोर मूविंग फर्दर जस्ट रिकॉल प्रीवियस लेक्चर. इन दैट वी लर्न the concept of context switching, its triggers and advantages and disadvantages of it. When CPU switches to another process, the system must save the state of the old process and load the saved state for the new process is called as context switch. Means context switching involves storing the context or state of a process so that it can be reloaded when required and execution can be resumed. From the same point as earlier, this is a feature of multitasking operating system and allows a single CPU to be shared by multiple processes. It is the one of the example of context switching. Here there are two processes, that is process P0 and process P1. The both are being running on the operating system. It is the part of multitasking or multiprogramming. In that, process P0 is switched out and process P1 is switched in because of an interrupt or a system call. Context switching involves the saving the state of process 0 into PCB0 and loading the state of process 1 from PCB1. Here, first process P0 is being running, it's executing, and process P1 is ideal. In that interrupt is occurred or system calls, the process P0 is switched out. At that time, save the state of process P0 into its PCB0 and process P1 is reload into the CPU from its PCB1. After some time, again context switching occurs and process P1 is switched out and process P0 is switched in. At that time, process P1 is saved its state into its PCB1 and reload the process P0 from its PCB0. It is the one of the example of context switch. It is also called CPU switch from one process to another process. Next, context switching has three triggers, that is multitasking, interrupt handling and user and kernel mode switching. In multitasking environment, a process is switched out of the CPU so another process can be run. The state of the old process is saved and the state of the new process is loaded. On a preemptive system, processes may be switched out by the scheduler. Next, that is the interrupt handling. In that, the hardware switches a part of the context when an interrupt occurs. This happens automatically. Only some of the context is changed to minimize the time required to handle the interrupt. Next, user and kernel mode switching. In that, a context switch may take place when transition between the user mode and kernel mode is required in the operating system. And last, the advantages and disadvantages of context switching. Context switching is used to achieve multitasking, that is multiprogramming with time sharing. Multitasking gives an illusion to the users that more than one process are being executed at the same time. Only one task is being executed at the particular instance of the time by a processor. Practically, only one task is being executed at the same time. But context switching is so fast that the user feels that the CPU is executing more than one task at the same time. And disadvantages of context switching are, it requires some time for context switching, means it's time consuming. Time is required to save the context of one process that is in the running state and the getting the context of another process that is about to come in the running state. During that time, there is no useful work done by the CPU from the user perspective. So it is a pure overhead. Today we are going to discuss the concept of process scheduling. Process scheduling is one of the most important activity related to the process. The aim behind scheduling is to get the CPU time. The objective of multiprogramming is to have some processes running at all time so as to maximize CPU utilization. Means the main objectives of operating system is multiprogramming. For multiprogramming, it is necessary to run multiple programs at all times. This utilizes CPU as well as I/O devices continuously. Second, the objectives of time sharing is to switch the CPU among processes so frequently that users can interact with each program while it is running. Means the second main aim of time sharing operating system is to keep CPU switching among multiple devices. To meet these both objectives of multiprogramming and time sharing operating system, the processes should schedule according to their priorities. A uniprocessor system can have only one running process, but if more processes exist, the rest must wait until the CPU is free and can be rescheduled. Means what? For a single processor, there will be only one process running at the given time. But in multiprogramming, more processes are being running, so they will have to wait till the CPU gets free and can be rescheduled. The processes are arranged in queue. Each process is associated with its respective process control block, that is PCB. The process scheduler selects an available process from set of available queues for the execution. For that purpose, there are different process scheduling queues are available. In the recent session, we have seen that when a process enters in the system, they are included in the job queue. First, that is the job queue. A process enters the system, they are put into a job queue. Means that the state of all processes in the system are stored in job queue. Second, that is the ready queue. Ready queue, it is nothing but set of all processes residing in main memory, ready and waiting to execute. Means what? The queue which stores the processes which are in the ready state and wants to enter in the running state is known as ready queue. Only one process can enter in the running state in a uniprocessor system. The other processes have to remain waiting in the ready state for their turn to come. The ready queue is generally stored as a linked list. A ready queue header contains pointer to the first and final PCB in the list. And last, that is the device queues. Device queue is the set of processes waiting for an I/O devices is called as device queue. Each device has its own device queue. So these are the some important process scheduling queues, that is the job queue, ready queue and device queue. All the processes in the system, those are stored in job queues. The processes are ready state and wants to enter in the running state, those are in the ready queue, and the set of processes waiting for an I/O devices, that is called as a device queue. It is the diagram of ready queue and various I/O devices. First is a ready queue and rest of all four are the device queue, that is the magnetic unit 0, magnetic tape unit 1, disk unit 0, terminal unit 0. These four are the device queue. And first, that is the ready queue. Generally, ready queues are represented in linked list. It contains two parts, that is the head and tail. In ready queue head, it is held the pointer of first PCB, while tail contains the last PCB of the list. In this figure, the queue is called as a ready queue when the process in the queue are residing or stored in the main memory and they are ready and waiting for CPU to get executed. These queues are stored as linked list. A ready queue header pointer contains pointer to the first and final process block controls in the list. Each process block contains a pointer field that points to the next PCB in the ready queue. There are again different types of queues in the system. While one process gets executed, after execution it may get interrupted. This is maybe because it requires input-output devices, or it may require disks for sharing, or maybe because of other reason it waits. The list of different processes which waits for a particular I/O devices is referred as device queue. Each device queue has its own device queue, which describes the number of processes waiting for it. This is the queue diagram, is a common representation of process scheduling. In this diagram, first is a ready queue which contains two parts, that is the head and tail. Head contains the pointer of first PCB in the list and tail contains the last PCB of the list. And rest four are the device queues, that is the magnetic tape unit 0, it contains linked list with header, head and tail. This list is empty, it is a null value. Second magnetic tape unit 1, it is a device queue, it is also null. Next, that is a disk unit 0, it is a device queue, it is also in the linked list, it contains head and tail. In that, head contains the pointer of first PCB, while tail contains the final PCB of the list. And here tail contains the pointer of PCB 3. Again, PCB 3 contains the pointer of its next PCB, that is the PCB 14. And again, PCB 14 contains the pointer of its next PCB, it is the PCB 6. While the tail contains last PCB of the list, that is the PCB 6. After that, the list is empty, it contains the null value. Next, that is the terminal unit 0. It is the device queue which contains head and tail. In that, only one PCB is present in this list. In that, head contain the first PCB, that is the PCB 5, and tail also contains the PCB 5, because in this queue only one PCB is allocated. So first and last PCB is only one, that is the PCB 5. So head contains the pointer of the first PCB, that is the PCB 5, and tail contains the pointers of last PCB of the list, that is the PCB 5. After that, it list is the empty. It is the ready queue and various IO devices queues. Next diagram, it is the representation of process scheduling. In this diagram, the process scheduling, there are two types of queues. The one is ready queue and other is the set of device queue. In this diagram, there are two queues are used. Mainly two queues are used, that is ready queue and other are the device queue. In this diagram, arrows indicate the direction or flow of the process in the system, and the rectangles, these rectangles represent the queue, and circle represent the resources which serve the queues. Initially, a new process is assigned for the execution or it is dispatched. When a process is allocated to the CPU, many situations or conditions could occur at the time. Means from the system, the processes are being ready for the execution. Those all processes are kept into ready queue. Now the processes which are ready for the execution, those are place in ready queue and one by one is dispatched into CPU for the further execution. When a process is allocated to CPU, many situations and conditions could be occurred at a time. The first, once process is being executed in CPU, if its all resources are completed and those processes are executed in given time, then the process should be terminated. Means it is terminated or deallocate the memory. If the process could issue related to IO requests, then the processes from the CPU is switched out to the device queue, and then it can be placed into IO queue. Here all the incompleted resources are fulfilled, and again once all the resources are fulfilled, then kept into ready queue. Next condition, the process could create a new sub-process and wait for the sub-process termination. It is parent and child creation. A new process is created, that is the parent process. And once that parent process is go into CPU for the further execution, if CPU wants to break that process into child's, again it is switched out from the CPU and kept into fork a child queue. In this condition, first their child's are executed. First child processes are executed. For the execution, again it goes to the ready queue. From the ready queue, again goes to the CPU and then executed one by one. And next condition, the process could be removed forcefully from the CPU as a result of an interrupt and can be put back into the ready queue. Means in CPU, the process has occurred any interrupt, then again those processes are switched out from the CPU and kept into interrupt device queue. And again interrupt occurs and put back into the ready queue and again goes to the CPU and being executed. In case one or two, it is observed that the process eventually switches from the waiting state to ready state and then put back into the ready queue. A process continues this cycle till it gets terminated. This is the time when process is removed from all queues and has its PCB and resource deallocated. A common representation of process scheduling is a queuing diagram. As earlier seen, there are two types of queues present, that is the ready queue and set of device queue. A new process is initially put in the ready queue. It waits in the ready queue until it is selected for the execution. Once a process is assigned to the CPU and is executing, one of the several event is occurred. First, the process could issue an IO request and then be placed in IO queue. Second event, the process could create a new subprocess and wait for its termination. In this case, parent is terminated once its all child's process are being terminated. Third event, the processes could be removed forcefully from the CPU in case of interrupt as a result of an interrupt and be put back into the ready queue. This is the queuing diagram. For this, three queues are used, that is job queue, ready queue and device queue. Job queue is collection or set of all processes in the system present at a particular moment. Ready queue is collection of all processes that are residing in main memory. Also, these processes are ready and are waiting for execution. Device queue is set of or collection of processes waiting for input-output devices. Each device has its own device queue. Recall all the points of scheduling. First, there are two main objectives of scheduling, that is the multiprogramming and time sharing. Multiprogramming, it is used to keep the CPU and IO devices continually busy. Time sharing is to switch the CPU among processes so frequently that users can interact with each program while it's running. For a single processor, there will be only one process running at the given time. But if there are many processes, that is the multiprogramming, they will have to wait till the CPU gets free and can be rescheduled. For this purpose, the processes are arranged in queue. Each process is associated with its respective process control block. The process scheduler selects an available process from set of available queues for the execution. For that, there are three different queues are used, that is job queue, ready queue and device queue. The job queues are all the processes in the system are kept into job queue. Ready queue is the set of all processes residing in main memory ready and waiting to execute. The queue which stores the processes which are in the ready state and wants to enter in the running state is known as ready queue. Only one process can enter in the running state in a uniprocessor system. The other processes have to remain waiting in the ready state for their turn to come. A large number of algorithms are available to transfer the process from ready state to running state. Generally, ready queue is stored as linked list. It contains two parts, that is the head and tail. Ready queue header contains the pointer to the first PCB and tail contains the final PCB in the list. Device queue. It is the set of processes waiting for an I/O devices. Each device has its own device queue. It is a ready queue and various device queue. In that, the first is a ready queue which contains two parts, that is the head and tail. Here, head contains the pointer of first PCB while tail contains the last PCB in the list. Further, four are the device queues, that is the MAC tape unit 0, MAC tape unit 1, disk unit 0, terminal unit 0. These are the device queue. First device queue, it contains null value. There is no PCB in the list. In second also, it contains the null value, means there is no any PCB in the list. The third device queue, it contains the three PCB. In that, head contains the pointer of first PCB while tail contains the pointer of last PCB in the list. And last device queue, it contains only one PCB in the list. Head contains the first PCB, pointer of first PCB, while tail contains the pointer of last PCB. It is the representation of process scheduling. There are two queues are used, that is the ready queue and number of device queue. A ready queue, the processes are kept which are ready for the execution. One by one goes to the CPU. In that, it occurs three events. Those are, the process could issue an I/O request and then it back to into the ready queue, I/O queue, and back go into the ready queue. Second, time slice expired. Each and every process has some time limit to execute their process. One of the process is not terminated in given time, again it is switched from the CPU and go to into time slice and again go to the ready queue and assign next time slice. Next, that is the forker child. In CPU, process creates sub process, it goes to the forker child device queue. Here, childs are being executed in the ready queue and terminate. And last, that is, the process could be removed forcefully from a CPU as a result of interrupt and can be put back into the ready queue. Here, arrow is used or indicate the flow of control and direction. Here, rectangles are represent the different queues and circle, it represent the resources. Thank you.